The song Santa Claus is Coming to Town is true for this area in the Republic. In fact, he's already here. Specialist Jeff Olsen was on hand with hundreds of excited children as Santa checked in to the Dragon Hill Lodge.
Santa's busiest night of the year is just 3 weeks away. And with the reindeer and last-minute training exercises for the big night, Santa had to rely on Rudolph the Red-Nosed Limo Driver to make his check-in time at the Dragon Hill.
Y'all being good boys and girls this year? I'm going to check my list when I get back. I'll check my list.
Breakfast with Santa is Saturday morning from 8 until 10. And pictures with Santa will be taken from 11 till 2 weekends until Christmas. But what will Santa do in his off time at the Dragon? Well, aside from doing what it takes to make sure that those chimneys are still a tight squeeze on Christmas Eve.
You know, something tells me that looking for a man of Santa's stature here is just a waste of time. Everybody knows that Santa has a nose like a cherry, but if Santa had a nose like three cherries, he could win $275. We've obtained this requisition form that says you've been busy at work baking 20 dozen cookies, got 4 or 5 gallons of milk here, and there are even three boxes of oats. Can you explain those?
Quite honestly, I can't make any kind of comment on that stuff. How did you get this requisition?
Regardless of how Santa unwinds in the days building up to Christmas, he does have a special message for children in Korea.
I just want to wish all the children, Yongsan, all over Korea, all over the world, a Merry Christmas. And I hope that they get what they want for Christmas. My all's been working real hard, and I hope everybody has a real nice Christmas.
Specialist Jeff Olsen, AFKN News, Yongsan.
The primary leadership development course is necessary to become a non-commissioned officer in the U.S. Army. Specialist Jeff Olsen shows us a part of the course the students probably will never forget.
Good to go. You already loaded? Let me see. Let me see. Cool, got halfway. Release.
For some of these PLDC students, this will be the most intensive field training they ever experience. Simulated artillery and weapons fire resonate around the hilltop. The small group leaders are listening for something else.
We look not so much to turn a medical person into a combat person, but just to see if they can use the troop leading skills, communication skills, once the battle is initiated, and see if we hear some type of communication.
Lay down.
Soldiers from all MOSs come and participate in the field training exercise, but it's not necessarily the combat arms skills that the SGLs are looking for. Instead, it's an opportunity for the soldiers to display their leadership skills while under fire.
We pretty much had all the avenues covered here.
Being a good leader is sometimes being a good listener.
Weaknesses.
Instructors and students say in an exercise like this, it's wise for soldiers from non-combat-oriented MOSs to seek advice from their peers in the combat arms.
Coming back from a combat MOS, it gives you some experience to help, like the AG and some people that don't really train like that when they go to FTX. In return, they give us some helpful hands from sitting like 10 stuff they do often. So we get to experiment and train with each other and use each other's skills to help each other out.
Many of the students will never experience these combat scenarios again. But the soldiers say the lessons they've learned under fire will make them better leaders no matter what their duties entail. Specialist Jeff Olsen, AFKN News, Camp Hovey.
Tis the season and all the ingredients are in place. Crisp temperatures, snow flurries, Santa checking into the Dragon Hill Lodge, and the annual lighting of Area 2's Christmas tree. Specialist Jeff Olsen has more.
A barbershop chorus.
Thank you very much.
Some sleight of hand.
Oh, I saw that one.
And candy for the kids kicked off the Christmas season in Area 2. The night's big event was flipping the switches at Moyer Rec Center, which lit 4 Christmas trees around Yongsan. Cub Scout George Spriggs and Brownie Kate Stevenson did the honors.
there are many nice chances to get involved in some Christmas activities. Sometimes I think it might be even a little more fun here.
The Dove Choir delivered the final performance of the ceremony, which marks the beginning of dozens of 34th Support Group holiday activities.
Here in Korea, though, obviously we do have many unaccompanied soldiers, and so we're just trying to, as best we can, to schedule our activities and have the kinds of events that try to fill part of that void as they go through the season.
And, of course, Santa stopped by, giving the young and not so young a chance to share their Christmas wishes.
Even soldiers who are away from home can make this a memorable holiday season. With a basketball tournament, holiday parties, and the Dallas Cowboy cheerleaders visiting town, there's plenty for everybody to do. Hey, Santa, do you think I can get a Dallas Cowboy cheerleader for Christmas? Specialist Jeff Olsen, AFKN News, Yongsan.
And that's your AFKN News. Good night. Santa knows everything. Even the kids in Korea don't have the chance to sit on his lap at the local department store. So Yongsan's military affiliate radio system bridged that gap. Specialist Jeff Olsen has more on their chat with Santa.
Twas the week before Christmas and all throughout Seoul, kids wanted to know, would they get presents or coal? So the local Mars operator, with microphone in hand, sent a Christmas call across the North Pole's icy land. When what to her highly trained ear should she hear? St. Nick on the radio, coming in loud and clear.
Ho, 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 ho. Yes, Danielle. Ho, ho. I see you want a Barbie doll for Christmas.
He talked to the boys.
And I see you want a BB gun for Christmas. And a TV.
And he spoke with the girls. Some were quite shy. Others spoke in a whirl.
Some kind of toy that usually looks like kind of like a speed thing, but it's not. It's some kind of jet. I just want a jet, please. That's it.
Their teacher was thankful her kids got to speak.
On the way over on the bus, they told me we were going to go to the North Pole. So they actually thought this was the North Pole. They're pretty excited about being able to talk to him, and I'm sure they think that it's the real Santa on the other end.
And PFC Goss says Santa made it one special week.
It's real nice when they start to go out the door. They just wish you Merry Christmas. Some of them sing to us, you know, at the end of the talk to Santa. They really enjoy it. I think they really believe.
The chance to talk to Kris Kringle was one I could not miss. Hey, Santa, what's on my Christmas list? Santa said to all Korea as the signal lost its might.
I'd just like to wish all the children in Korea a very, very Merry Christmas.
And to all a good night. Specialist Jeff Olsen, AFKN News, Yongsan.
And that's your AFKN News for this Monday. Stay tuned. The commanding general of the 8th U.S. Army says that of all the awards presented to soldiers each year, the MacArthur Leadership Award is one of the most important. That's the award the Army annually bestows upon its top company commander. Specialist Jeff Olsen takes a look at this year's 8th Army nominees.
Duty, honor, country. Made a part of Army lore by General Douglas MacArthur, those traits were used to evaluate these company grade commanders. The 8 captains were considered for the Army-wide Leadership Award that bears General MacArthur's name.
As you can imagine, selecting the winner, even at this level, was no easy task. My compliments to the committee. The achievements of each of these outstanding officers today warrant recognition, but there can only be one MacArthur Award winner.
Captain Charles Bowery from the 1st of the 6th Cav received the 8th Army's nomination. The Apache helicopter pilot credits his diverse background and a three-pronged command philosophy.
Starts with leading by example. If any of my soldiers ever has a question about how to do something or what to do, maybe a difficult decision, I feel like they should be able to ask me or look at me and receive an example of how they should operate on a daily basis. Next, I'd say technical and tactical competence. And then finally, taking care of those soldiers that I'm entrusted with. Their lives are precious, and their skills are precious.
Captain Bowery's credentials will be reviewed, along with 23 other nominees from the Army's major commands. The winner will be announced at a ceremony in Washington this spring. Specialist Jeff Olsen, AFKN News, Yongsan.
Yongsan's thespians are doing their best to put the community in the holiday spirit with a musical adaptation of A Christmas Carol. Specialist Jeff Olsen gives a sneak peek at the classic holiday story.
It is Christmas Day, sir, and it's only one day a year.
It is a poor excuse for picking a man's pocket every 25th of December.
There's only one man who could be bellowing those blasphemies during the holiday season.
I appreciate your kindness, Mr. Scrooge.
The Yongsan Performing Arts Center is putting its final touches on Scrooge, a musical adaptation of Charles Dickens' A Christmas Carol.
Well, I think the audience is in for a really professional performance. And we've bound together in this idea that none of us are stars, none of us are outstanding. It's only the show itself that is the focus, and so our effort is to make the show the star, to make the show as good as it possibly can be.
The production follows the same storyline as the Dickens classic. Actors say using the musical version helps them put audience members in the holiday spirit.
I think the main thing is the language is updated for the most part. There aren't a lot of original Dickens lines in it, a few, but it's somewhat updated. The best thing about it is that it's still a marvelous story of redemption.
The curtain goes up at the Moyer Rec Center at 7:30 tonight through Saturday, and for a matinee performance at 3 on Sunday. Specialist Jeff Olsen, AFKN News, Yongsan.
And that's your AFKN News for this Wednesday. Stay tuned. CNN Headline News is next. Good night. The holidays are a busy time as we prepare to celebrate in our own personal way. The holidays are also busy for the American Red Cross. Specialist Jeff Olsen explains the importance of staying in touch with your family and unit as you celebrate the season.
This is a special Red Cross announcement for Specialist John Smith from the 121 General Hospital. Please contact your unit or your local Red Cross at 724-945.
On average, the American Red Cross in Korea tries to reach 15 service members daily. Red Cross officials say that number increases during the holiday season.
Emergencies are particularly acute. People really want to have their relatives back at the bedside when there's an emergency around Christmas time or around the holidays. So maybe somebody that might not have thought it was as serious some other time, it tends to take on more seriousness when it gets around Christmas time.
To reduce the time it takes for troops to be contacted in the event of an emergency, the Red Cross recommends you take the following steps. 1. Keep in touch with your family and let them know your holiday plans. 2. If you're going on leave or taking a pass, let your unit know where you'll be. And 3. If you change your plans after going on pass, notify your unit.
This is an emergency Red Cross announcement for Specialist John Smith.
If the Red Cross is not able to reach service members through their units, announcements can be broadcast.
Before we can make those announcements, though, we must have the confirmation from the Red Cross, which will then enable us to put the announcements on the air.
But if you keep in touch with your family and your unit, the Red Cross can better keep you abreast of emergency information from home. Specialist Jeff Olsen, AFKN News.
The Yongsan community celebrated the grand opening of the Youth Activity Center with a ribbon-cutting ceremony. Specialist Jeff Olsen shows us what the new center has to offer.
Children in Yongsan have a new place to work out, play ball, or just hang out with each other. The $2.1 million Youth Fitness Center opened this morning, just as school is out for the winter break.
Long overdue, this multi-purpose center is now the keystone of our youth services facilities. It is the finest in Korea and is the envy of many CONUS-based posts in the Army today.
2, 3.
All right.
There it is. All right.
After the ribbon-cutting, adults and children toured the new facility. They were impressed with what they saw.
We've been waiting for about a year for it to open, and we were really impressed because we used to like have to go from school down to Collier to work out or whatever. Now we can come like to the teen center.
This holiday present to the Youngsan youth is much more than just a basketball court and an exercise facility. The day room and snack bar area here is a place where Youngsan youth can relax and unwind on the weekends and after school. There's also a computer room with internet access where the students can do their studying, and a disco where students can have parties on the weekends. The facility is open to children 6 through 18. Operating hours vary. The staff pledges to have lots of activity going on when the doors are open. Specialist Jeff Olsen, AFKN News, Youngsan.
Meanwhile, the 31st Marine Expeditionary Unit geared up with 1,500 Republic of Korea Marines for exercise full eagle. We get that story from Specialist Jeff Olsen.
As the sun rises peacefully over Toksokri Beach, located just north of the port city of Pohang, a joint amphibious assault force of more than 2,100 U.S. and ROC Marines prepares to attack fortified positions along the coastline. This early morning amphibious assault was designed to test the cooperation between U.S. and ROC forces during this year's full eagle exercise. In less than 2 hours, naval units converted the once quiet beach into a fully operating embarkation point for troops and equipment.
Well, we had some ROC Marines on ship with us all week. We also have Anglico, which is actually on a Korean ship right now. They've been with them for about a week. So the cooperation, the interaction that's been happening between the U.S. Marines and the Korean Marines already so far has been just really amazing to watch. And I think there's a lot of learning going on both sides.
Exercises like Full Eagle allow a force such as the 31st Marine Expeditionary Unit to test its ability to respond quickly to any potential trouble spot in the world.
In my mind, the purpose for the MEU is so that if anything happens anywhere in the world, we're able to respond to that and be able to sustain ourselves for 15 days, which gives the other services enough time.
And both Youngsan and Osan, we get the story from Specialist Jeff Olsen.
Youngsters between the ages of 6 and 17 are lacing up their high tops and working on their layups as the youth services basketball season gets underway. While the league has been around for many years, this season the youngsters have a new place to show off their skills.
What is significant about this year's program is that we have a brand new multi-purpose facility to be used for this event and many others. For this basketball season itself, we have about 45 teams registered and well over 450 kids.
With that many boys and girls playing on 45 teams, Youth Services had to find 45 volunteers who were willing to coach these budding stars.
The main thing to push is to keep the enthusiasm, the good sportsmanship-like conduct, not so much the win-win, even though I realize that's important. But at this age, you want to instill the sportsmanship. I enjoy, as you see me jumping around, I enjoy the excitement and the spontaneity of the kids' play.
All of the youngsters will be running the court through February. That's when YS's version of March Madness kicks in, with playoffs for the kids who are 10 and older. Specialist Jeff Olsen, AFKN News, Youngsan.
If you're looking for bargains when buying a new car from a Korean dealership, you can find help on post at the Provo Marshal's office to make sure the deal you're offered is just right for you. Specialist Jeff Olsen concludes our series on buying a new car in the Republic.
The won rate has some service members exploring the options of purchasing a new car in Korea. And sticker prices on some showroom vehicles sold off post appear to have created substantial bargains for Americans. But military officials warn troops that buying a vehicle on the Korean economy can lead to hidden costs down the road.
Issues that need to be aware of are such things as EPA standards. Do they meet the emission control standards required in the United States for import of the car? And Department of Transportation standards.
The message Colonel Burleson has for buyers is that whether they're getting a good deal depends on who they are, what they're buying, and where they're going next.
Customs and tax issues, it's not the status of the individual who's purchasing the car necessarily, all that has that plays into it, but also it's the status of that specific car. Also, they need to find out, to go to transportation and find out what their entitlement is for that specific car for shipping the car back to the United States.
The Provost Marshal's office isn't telling people not to buy vehicles off post. It is encouraging them to consult with it and the transportation office before signing on the dotted line. Specialist Jeff Olsen, AF.
This weekend, the Department of the Army will make the 8th United States Army an Army Service Component Command. Joining us in the studio to explain this change is Specialist Jeff Olsen. Jeff?
Thank you, Sam. And joining us tonight is Colonel Mark Gerner. He's the Chief of Force Development and Plans for the 8th U.S. Army. Thank you for joining us this evening.
Thank you. Good to be here.
What is the significance of the 8th U.S. Army becoming an Army Service Component Command?
The change that has happened and will continue to happen over the near future is that whereas the 8th U.S. Army in the past has been a headquarters that was concerned principally about management functions and force provision functions, things like logistics and things commonly known as U.S. Title 10 support, has changed now to where there's a recognition around the United States Army that command and control at higher echelons, that is echelons above the level of the Corps commander, need to become both management and operational. In some respects, this is a way into the future because it's a recognition about current and future capabilities within the United States Army, and therefore the requirement to command and control and to make formal study of those capabilities as applied to the theater. But in final answer to your question, the significance is that this headquarters delivers to the commander-in-chief a range of options that he really did not have before. And he can depend on his Army component commander for these options.
Why did the Department of the Army make this change?
It happened in a careful study and analysis of many of the Army's experiences, not the least of which was Desert Shield and then Desert Storm. And the terribly hard job that the 3rd U.S. Army had in those years, actually between 90 and one could argue into 92 and 93, that the 3rd U.S. Army commander was presented with many, many things that they had to deal with on the run. It had to do with the scale and scope of the operations because they become so large. What happened then was that the U.S. Army Training and Doctrine Command, as well as the Department of the Army Operations, undertook the question of how should we design headquarters above the echelon of Corps. And within that, the 8th Army is one of three. The 8th Army, of course, is in direct support of SYNC Combined Forces Command. The 3rd Army is in support of Commander U.S. Central Command, principally oriented on the Middle East. The 3rd U.S. Army, of course, is in Atlanta. And the 7th U.S. Army in Europe is also on its way into this very similar design. So we are actually one of three armies around the world.
What are the changes that service members here in Korea will notice as a result of this change?
Well, I'm not sure what the service member or the soldier in the ranks will notice, probably very little, if anything. What the commanders will notice and do notice already as you practice this on command post exercises is that the command control communications and intelligence functions are now being handled at the level of the Army, we call it the Army Component Commander. And the Army component commander in that regard is taking his rightful place aside the other component commanders. Those are the Naval component, the Air Force component, the Marine component, Special Operations component. So the people who notice the difference are the major subordinate commanders and potentially the organizations that come in here in time of crisis, and hopefully not, but in time of war. The visible symbols of this will be principally in the way the senior commanders work on command post exercises.
Okay. And finally, I know it's a broad question, but what do you see in the future for the 8th U.S. Army?
in the future, I see that whatever the political future and the military composition of forces on the peninsula will be, and that, of course, is a question that everyone likes to pose. Whatever that future will be, there is going to be a need for the presence of U.S. forces. The presence of U.S. forces, to include the command and control of U.S. forces, delivers an element of regional stability, which is part of our national strategy and part of the strategies and plans within the service. So be the future of the peninsula peace and unity and some political outcome, you're going to need the presence of the U.S. Army, and clearly its jobs will be a little different than what it is now. But you are always going to need some kind of presence, and therefore you're going to need some kind of command and control element for that presence.
Colonel Gerner, I know it's been a busy week for you. I appreciate you making time to join.
Sit back and relax for this next story. Specialist Jeff Olsen says going to the movies in Yongsan is about to become a little more comfortable.
It's a chair-raising experience. Workers at Yongsan's Balboni Theater this week are replacing the 500 seats which moviegoers use, and officials say the new ones are quite an improvement.
The seats rock back and forth. They're very well built, so they're not going to require repair. And the unique part of these seats is they have cup holders, which the command was very, very happy to get for the soldiers.
Now, before you complain that the Army has spent more money on a frivolous project, hold on to your seat. Mr. Kasrick points out that the theater serves an important military function as well.
This is not really a theater. It's a training hall, and it belongs to the 34th Support Group, and it's used 20 to 25 days a month as a training facility.
Workers began this version of musical chairs on Monday, and everything should be finished by the weekend. In the meantime, if you're coming to the movies in Yongsan and you want a good seat for the show, you might want to get here a few minutes early. Specialist Jeff Olsen, AFKN News, Youngstown.
In other news, if two troop trucks carrying soldiers during a contingency operation collide, the result could be mass chaos. Instead, leaders at Yongsan's 121 General Hospital have staged this mass casualty exercise to ensure their troops will be ready if such a tragedy ever were to occur. Specialist Jeff Olsen has more.
These actors won't win any Academy Awards. Still, they're playing a vital role in testing the on-scene decision-making skills. Of emergency medical personnel assigned to the 121 General Hospital. This Saturday morning exercise involves almost every soldier assigned to the medical command at Yongsan. The challenge? To rapidly and efficiently treat the dozen victims of this truck accident. While stabilizing the victims, medics also must determine who will receive treatment first. After transporting casualties to the emergency room, a makeshift triage area is set up in the parking lot. The exercise continues under the watchful eyes of command evaluators. Inside the ER, doctors make further evaluations as another factor, the real post-ride power outage, adds to the drama. Some patients are taken to trauma rooms, while others are off to surgery for the final stage of the exercise.
It allows us to see where our strengths and weaknesses lie, how our supply channels run, how our patient flow runs from the time they get to the emergency room to finally making it up to surgery if they need to have surgery. It allows us to evaluate how well we can manage a large influx of patients at one time.
This is also a learning experience for the medical personnel who participate as victims in the drill.
We just go through it, and then if it happens in real life, we can understand it and know the difference and what to do.
The exercise will wind down by noon, and as the 121 staff members return to their routine operations, they say they feel a little more confident that they're ready for a worst-case scenario. Specialist Jeff Olsen.
And that's your AFK News for this Tuesday. We leave you with a look at some very happy kids after officials completed the installation of 11 new South Post playgrounds. Residents of Young Sons Blackhawk Village held a ceremony to mark the occasion, and Specialist Jeff Olsen and Catoosa Sergeant Jung Il Young were there. Stay tuned. CNN Headline News is next. Good night.
I think everybody's pretty excited about the new equipment, aren't you?
Yeah!
I think that probably says it all, doesn't it?
What are you doing here on the new playscape?
Hanging around.
I love it!
The old equipment had a lot of problems, but this is good. It's challenging for the children, both mentally and physically. You can see it has a lot more color. It's much more inviting to all the children, and it is wonderful.
General Shelton also toured one of the world's most heavily guarded borders. Specialist Jeff Olsen has more.
How are you?
After the chairman visited troops at the multi-purpose range complex, he toured the joint security area, which is manned by U.S. and ROC forces who stand in front of them all.
I've been very impressed with, in every place that I've been, with the great relationship I see between the U.S. and their ROC counterparts. That starts at the very top and extends right down to the tactical level, as I've witnessed here today in the joint security area.
Although some members of Congress are concerned that constant deployments and family separations are eroding the force, General Shelton refutes that theory.
Myself, General Tulele, most of the senior leaders in the Army today came up through that hollow force, and we'd recognize it when we see it. And we're nowhere near having a hollow force. In fact, what I've seen here on the peninsula has reinforced the fact that our forward deployed and our first to fight are trained and ready.
Despite the hardships troops like these at Observation Point Olette face, General Shelton feels all service members in Korea, including these JSA scouts, remain well prepared.
The amount of training they're doing, it's tough training, it's realistic training, challenging training, and obviously preparing them for any potential contingency that they might face here in on the peninsula.
Specialist Jeff Olsen, AFKN News, Observation Post, Olette.
Still to come, a handful of workers, mostly civilians, help keep combat supply ships afloat. Plus, the Army keeps the lines of communication open for the Navy and Marines. Stay with us.